My name is Adrian. I've been working for Analog Devices for the past 3 years as a software developer, and I'm going to show you how we are using Dune Radio to do signal acquisition and analysis with our Scopy software and the M2K, which is our board. So before we begin, Robin mentioned yesterday that about the Active Learning Program, which is basically a program that's dedicated to inspiring students to better understand the analog world, but also to introduce technology in the classroom. So the program consists in a couple of entry-level hardware platforms. So we have the M1K. We have the M1K that is the ADELM 1000, the M2K, which I'll be presenting, that's the ADELM 2000, and the Pluto, which Michael mentioned yesterday. That's an SDR. We also provide labs and free courseware materials at that link below. So the hardware is basically a USB powered instrument. So it's built on the same infrastructure as the Pluto, and that Michael mentioned yesterday. So it basically has a Zinc SoC, which runs embedded Linux, but the analog front end is different. It doesn't have an RF front end, and it features AD9963, which is more of an instrumentation kind of chip. Also having the same infrastructure, it has the same connectivity options, so you can connect it to the PC using a USB or a Wi-Fi dongle or memory stick or whatever. Actually, the memory stick is not too connected to the PC, but you get what I'm saying. So the hardware it features a two-channel 100 megasamples per second ADC, a two-channel 150 megasamples per second DAC. It also features a plus-minus 5-volt power supply, as well as 16 digital inputs and outputs, which can be buffered at 100 megasamples per second. So the hardware is all open source. You can find it at you can find the schematics and the firmware at the links in the slides. The software Scopy is our touch-friendly, modern-looking software. It is based on Qt5, so it's cross-platform. It's cross-platform and it runs on Windows, Linux, and Mac. So it uses the hardware to implement virtual instruments such as the oscilloscope, the signal generator, the voltmeter, power supply, spectrum analyzer, network analyzer, logic analyzer, and pattern generator. And it uses GNU Radio to do the signal processing and acquisition especially for the analog part. The software is also open source, and you can find it on GitHub at the link. So here I have a small demo. I have a breadboard here which has basically an R2R ladder deck, and I fitted in digital data from the pattern generator, and we can monitor what the analog output looks like. So. This is the pattern generator. So here I basically have a binary counter, which is a 4-bit counter that counts up to 16. And we use the power supply to power up the operational amplifier. And we can see here the actual output of the DAC and of the operational amplifier, basically 16 levels the signal has basically 16 levels. That's kind of what we expected. So I'm going to get back to the presentation. Why did we choose GNU Radio? Well, it provides lots of signal processing blocks that were useful for our application. The library is geared towards performance, so we know it runs on most PCs, and it already had a QWT-based visualization block, so we used those and extended those as well to fit our application. So in order to better understand how the system works, we have to go through the signal chain. So the M2K is basically an embedded Linux host, which uses the IIO subsystem to manage its inputs and outputs. And libIIO basically abstracts the low-level details of the system. So like Michael said, so it's the same as for Pluto. The M2K runs the IIOD application. The IIOD application, which provides the IIO data remotely via USB or via IP or even over a serial link. So on the other end, we use GRIIO, which is a GNU radio out of tree module to interface between GNU radio and our own IIO devices. So how do we use GNU radio? Well, we created this IIO manager class, which is basically a multiplexer between the IOs and the instruments. So you can't have multiple instruments running that use the same resources. So you can't have like the oscilloscope and the spectrum analyzer running at the same time. So in order to prevent this from happening, we created this kind of multiplexer which turns off and turns on the instruments based on what the user wants. So what we found out that GNU radio flow graphs are not really meant to be changed on the fly. So in order to do this, in order to circumvent this, we made use of the copy block, which basically isolates a part of the GNU radio flow in order to prevent data from going to those instruments. Also, sometimes that wasn't enough. So whenever we create a block in the IIO manager, the IIO manager basically remembers that a block was created and the connections between the blocks. So eventually, when you want to delete a block, you can the IIO manager knows how to recursively delete every block that was connected to the source block you want to delete, right? So I'm going to go a little bit over the oscilloscope instrument. It is a two-channel, 100 megasamples per second ADC. It has a plus minus 20-volt input range, and it is capable of triggered operation. So some of the features that use GNU radio are autoset, AC coupling, reference channels, and math channels. A few words about the acquisition and triggering. GNU radio flows do not usually have the concept of triggering, so in order to do this, in order to create the concept of triggering, basically GRIIO tags, makes use of stream tags. It basically tags where the start of a buffer is. So when you query the device, the GRIIO block runs IIO buffer refill, so it tags the start of that buffer in the stream. Having that information and knowing where the trigger is, you can accurately plot the waveform on the screen. The next feature that we have on the oscilloscope is the autoset feature, which helps the user set the time base, the volts per division, and trigger settings. So in order to do this, we use the GNU radio FFT block to find the highest amplitude tone in the signal. We sweep through all of the available sample rates of the oscilloscope in order to extend the range of the autoset. And whenever a suitable tone is found, we search the buffer for the peaks. And according to the peaks, to the minimum and maximum, we set the volts per division and we set the trigger to half that in order to correctly get the signal. The next feature that uses GNU radio is oscilloscope AC coupling. So AC coupling basically removes the DC component from the acquired signal. We implemented a digital low-pass filter, and we subtracted the original signal from the filtered result in order to remove the DC component. However, since this is a digital filter, it's not in the analog front end. There are certain limitations. So the original signal needs to be within hardware input ranges. So it has to be between plus and minus 20 volts. And setting the trigger is kind of complicated because the trigger is, you can see the trigger visually on the screen, but on the analog part, it's actually a lot higher because you have to trigger on the original signal, not on the filter signal. The trigger is hardware. Reference waveforms are basically waveforms that you can save and load later. And in order to implement this, we basically took a vector sync. With this vector sync, we get the data out of it. We encapsulate it in a format that's easy to read and save it to a CSV file. So if later you want to compare the signal you've acquired in the past to the signal you're acquiring now, you can load it up from a CSV file, load it to a vector source, and display it on the screen. Next, we have the oscilloscope math channels. So these oscilloscope math channels make use of the IIO math block from GRIIO. So this block basically tries to create a hierarchical block dynamically from a mathematical equation in a string. It uses a Flex and Bison parser in order to create this block at runtime. And it can take any signal, it can also take multiple inputs. So I have an example here of the IIO math block, which is sine of x plus sine of 3 times x divided by 3. So basically, what we do, So basically, what it does is that it takes x, uses the x is the input, it uses the transcendental block to do the sine of that, and the result of that will be added to the other part, or to the other signal, which is 3x multiplied, then you apply sine over that and divide everything by 3. So this, all of this happens at runtime. The string is parsed at runtime. The blocks get created at runtime, and you have the result again at runtime. So the signal generator, which is also called the AWG, arbitrary waveform generator, is another instrument that we have. It is used to generate basic signal types such as sine, triangular, square wave, or sawtooth. All of these are provided by the six source block in GNU Radio. We also support a multitude of file inputs such as a binary, wave file source, which is also provided by GNU Radio, and the CSV and MAT formats, where we basically do parsing and throw everything in a vector source. Noise is on top of any signal. You can add noise. Noise is also provided by the noise source GNU Radio block. The instrument also has a spectrum. The software also has a spectrum analyzer that goes up to 50 megahertz range. We use the FFT block to compute the spectrum. We use GNU Radio to apply different kinds of windowing to the signal. And we also implemented averaging and the marker functionality on the spectrum analyzer. The network analyzer is another instrument that computes the frequency and phase response of a circuit. It sweeps through all of the frequencies using the arbitrary waveform generator and feeds that signal to the device, let's say the device under test. And then for each of the frequencies, it computes the frequency and phase response of the circuit and plots it on the screen. And we use GNU Radio to do that. We plot the frequency and phase. So in this case, we use the Bode plot, but we also support Nyquist and Nichols plots for showing the results of the network analysis. This is the GNU Radio flow for the network analyzer. I'm not going to go into much detail about this, but in case you are curious, this is what it looks like. We also have logic instruments, but these don't make use of GNU Radio. So we have a 16-channel logic analyzer and pattern generator that goes up to 100 megasamples per second. Plotting is provided by PulseView. For the signal acquisition and decoding, we use libio, libsigrok, and libsigrok decode libraries. So it can handle countless of protocols such as I2C, SPI, UART, JTAG, and all of them are courtesy of the libsigrok decode library. So there's this thing which is called the Scopy scripting environment. Qt provides a scripting environment which is based on JavaScript, and we enabled our applications, let's say, scripting capabilities, where you can basically perform instrument setup. And automate your measurements using simple JavaScript. And we use this scripting functionality even in our production, in our production environment in the factory to test the M2Ks to see that they work correctly. There's a downside, however, that you have to run Scopy in order to automate these instruments. So also, developers can create their own instruments. The Tool Launcher class and Tool class provide a baseline for all of these instruments. I have an example on GitHub. It's under the dummy instrument branch. It's basically an example I put together that I'm going to show you right now that provides like a baseline on how to create your own stuff. So I go back to Scopy. You can see the orange line. That is the output of a light-dependent sensor. So if I put some shade over it, you can see that the voltage given by the sensor changes. So I created this dummy instrument, which kind of looks like this. And you can set up the bias voltage for the sensor, and you can check out the sensor output. And when I start the experiment, the color of the yellow widget changes based on how much light I give it. So it's a simple example that shows how you can use Scopy to create your own stuff. OK. So in conclusion, we liked working with GNU Radio because we can easily modify the signal chain. We can add signal processing features very easily by modifying a few lines of code. And it has lots of blocks that we can use like out of the box. And we don't have to deal with the math behind them. What we didn't like about GNU Radio was that we can't do easy flow reconfiguration. And we've had some problems with that. But there are workarounds around it. I must confess that I'm kind of a GNU Radio noob, but myself personally, I ran into some problems when developing blocks that whenever a block chokes and or doesn't output data like I expected, it's kind of hard to see where the choke comes from. So basically, in my experience, what happened was that the whole flow graph stops or chokes and nothing comes out on the other side, and it's pretty hard to debug. So our future plans for Scopy, for this software, is to add support for other I/O devices, such as the Pluto SDR. We also want to make better plugin support, so there is no need to recompile everything. Every time you want to build a new instrument, we can make use of the scripting environment for that. And we also intend to create the libm2k. So right now, we interface the device using I/O, which can be cumbersome. But we want to create the libm2k, which will make interfacing with the device a lot easier. So if you have any questions, I'm willing to answer them. We'll also have the board running in the booth in the other room. So if you want a live demo of it, make sure to come by. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Adrian. All right, time for questions. Moritz.
So first of all, cool talk. I was wondering, if I were to, like, did you guys try other I/O sources?
Other I/O sources?
Say, you know, I have something that already has an I/O driver, an ADC or something.
We did, but not for Scopy. So the GRIO out of three module supports other I/O sources, basically supports the I/O framework, and so the newest thing that Travis added was that you can also set attributes, not only the data stream, but you can set attributes from GRIO, and we definitely tried it and we use it for other devices. We just don't use it in Scopy yet, but we will in the future.
Okay, so the question I was asking is, like, say I have like a microcontroller that has a bunch of ADCs on it, and you know I write an I/O driver, like how much additional work do I have to do to then get it work all the way up to Scopy?
Well, right now quite a bit.
Okay, thanks.
Oh wait, if you're not talking to the mic, it doesn't get recorded. Tim, could you go ahead and switch out laptops if you're going to use your own?
So really the intent of this libm2k is to actually split this M2K, this ADLM2000 hardware logic out of Scopy and make it a generic I/O instrument so that can you use it with any, pretty similar with AI/O oscilloscope where it actually works with any I/O device, and that's pretty much the end goal of that restructuring that's already started, but right now it doesn't work.
Okay, any other questions? No? All right. Thank you very much, Adrian.
Thank you.